Hello and welcome to our Sunday morning service at Holy Apostles, Charlton Kings and St Michael's Whaddon here in Cheltenham. Very warm welcome to everybody. It's a little bit Valdunican this morning. The church is busy setting itself up. We're opening for new services this Sunday, back up after the lockdown, and we've got the Christmas tree going up and all sorts of stuff is happening. So I'm recording this across in the vicarage, and so I'm in my nice big red chair, and it does feel as if I should have a guitar singing some kind of songs, but that is probably the last thing that you want this Sunday, to have me singing any songs for you. Warm welcome if you're a guest or a visitor. This is the first time you've found Holy Apostles and St Michael's. If you want to know anything more about us as churches, please do get in touch. You can contact me, Ashley at holyapostles.org.uk, or go through the church office on churchoffice@holyapostles.org.uk, and we'd love to send any information you want and answer any questions that you have about the church. A couple of notices, well, more than a couple actually, because we're heading into the busy season. The first thing is we've got a midday Zoom today for church members. If you want to catch up, it's just have a coffee and chat to those folk that we've not been able to spend any time with. Midday today, the contact details, the connection details for that Zoom went out in the church bulletin this week. We will put them on the closed church Facebook page as well. So if you use those, if you want to connect up with other folk midday today. Throughout the week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, we've got our coffee morning prayer sessions at 10:30 on our Facebook page, HA Cheltenham. But those videos stay on Facebook the whole time, so you can catch up with them whenever you want to. And if you want to know what's happening down at Cornerstone Community Centre, the community centre connected to St Michael's in Whaddon, there's a little drop-in on different days of the week there on their Facebook page, Cornerstone Community Centre. If you search for that on Facebook, you'll find them, and James, Martin, or one of the team will be doing a little drop-in normally around any time between 9 and sort of 10 o'clock, really. But do try and catch up with those there. Well worth finding. Other notices. Well, a big thank you to everyone who was involved in the children's Christmas party yesterday. A big thank you to Thomas Trilby and the Snowflake Elf for all of that. The next children's event coming up, of course, is our Messy Church Christingle. Again, because of the nature of things, that's going to be a church members only thing, because we don't have a lot of space in the church to hold it. But that's on the 13th. If you want to know more about that, get in touch with Beanie or again through the church office, and you can find out more. If you're on Church Suite, you'll already know about that. Lastly, pop-up prayer every Thursday at the moment, 7:45 for 15 minutes Thursday evening. Again, that's for church members. We're coming together just to pray for everything that's happening at the moment. And the connection details for that will also have gone out in the church bulletin. And if you're sitting there thinking, I don't get the church bulletin, I feel a little left out, now is the time to get in touch with the church and sign up to Church Suite. And we can send out a weekly email to you, that bulletin, and lots of information in that that you won't pick up here on a Sunday. Alrighty. All the words are on the screen. So if you want to join in with the service as we go through, please do. And let's take a few moments quiet as we begin. And I'm going to light this candle for Advent, because Jesus is the light of the world, and he is coming into the world and into our lives this Christmas. Let's take a little quiet. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Amen. So this is our first song, normally I want to jump up and down, there's some actions to do with it, and it's a Christmas medley. Wasn't that great? It's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas, isn't it, as they say. Now, if you want more resources for your children, Beanie, our children and families worker, has been producing all sorts of little videos that are coming out each week, and you can find them on this very YouTube channel. If you search the playlists for Mini Club and Sunday Club, and they're excellent little videos that you can use with particularly younger children. Go to them now, or you can watch this and go to them later. They'll obviously stay up the whole time on our YouTube channel for whenever you need them. Now, I've already said we're in Advent, and Advent is this season of the year where we take time to think ahead to Christmas and look backwards to the first Christmas, the arrival of Jesus 2,000 years ago, and look ahead to that promise that he is going to come again in all fullness. And in the meantime, ask the question, what would it mean for Jesus to come and meet me here and now? And so Advent is a season of the year we take time to think through the different ways that perhaps we're not really where God would want us to be. And so as we start the service this morning, you might want to give to God all of those things that perhaps you regret, you'd rather not have done or said, or you really think you should have done and said. And perhaps it's a time as well to let go of those things that have been done to you that are maybe sticking around as obstacles to what God wants to do in your life. I'm going to put some words up on the screen, and if you would like, why not join in with these? Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. It's time for another song, and this is Chris Tomlin and his version of Joy to the World.
Let us pray. Father God, as we come towards you now, help us to still our hearts and minds. At this time of year, as the nights are long, and particularly this year, with all the trials and tribulations that COVID-19 has brought, we know that for many life can feel very dark. But we're reminded of your word in Revelation of a city to come, a city which does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. Amidst the continued restrictions of the tier system, the uncertainties of the vaccine rollout, and as we try to navigate if and how we might meet with family over the Christmas period, your word reminds us of the clarity that is found in the New Jerusalem, a place where uncertainty will have ended, and where there will be no more tears, mourning, pain, or sorrow. Lord, we rejoice in this promise. Thank you that your full character and being will light that place, and that we as your followers will be free to worship you there and see you face to face. So at this Advent time, when we look forward to your coming as a baby, help us to also remember your future promise of heaven. And I pray that we might seek comfort in that assurance. We particularly pray this peace for fellow believers around the world who may be hard pressed in many aspects of their lives because of their faith. And we bring before you countries that we might have on our hearts, such as Eritrea, Sudan, and the Yemen, where instability, war, and food shortages all exacerbate the isolation and mistreatment sometimes of believers. Lord, in just a small way, the lockdown has been a taste of the restrictions that many people around the world face all the time. And so it is with thanks that we think of the ways in which church teams up and down the country here in the UK, including here at Holy Apostles, are preparing for Christmas services and events, often this year in new ways. And while so many services will be very different this year, Lord, we pray that those differences will present new opportunities to us to reflect, be encouraged, and to share your message of light and life with our families, friends, and communities. And lastly, Lord, we pray for the process of getting the approved vaccine out to communities across the country as swiftly as possible. Lord, we pray and thank you for this breakthrough and pray that the challenges around distribution and staffing of the rollout would be safely met. Lord, hear our prayers this morning and still our hearts to hear your word. Amen.
Hidden glory in creation. Now
So we're in the season of Advent, and that means we're unpacking those stories that are very familiar to most of us about the first Christmas. And this morning I'm going to be looking at the passage from Luke where the angel Gabriel meets Mary for the first time. Before I do that, here's Anna to bring that reading.
This week's reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38, the birth of Jesus foretold. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
The accounts of Jesus' birth come from two of the Gospels, from Matthew and from Luke. But each of them treats their material in very different ways, and actually they have different material that they bring to the story. So Matthew, he seems to concentrate very much more on the men in the story. He begins with the genealogy of Joseph, Jesus' adoptive father. He tells the story of Joseph encountering the angel Gabriel in a couple of dreams and having his actions directed by those dreams. Also, Matthew tells us about the Magi. That's where we hear of them coming and journeying to see the Christ child. And he talks about the brutal Herod and his behavior. So Matthew seems to concentrate on men, and often men in positions of power within his story. His interest is to sort of raise up the status of Jesus because these big events are happening around him. Now, Luke's very different. Luke is probably a non-Jewish, a Gentile writer, a physician who traveled with the Apostle Paul, probably. And it's likely that he gathered his material when he had time in Jerusalem, when Paul was there, because he wouldn't have been able to go everywhere that Paul went. He wouldn't have been able, as a non-Jew, to go and meet with Jewish men, even the Christian Jewish men, in the same way. There wouldn't have been the freedom. And so Luke gathers his material from eyewitness testimony, it feels like, much more from those who are on the edge of the society in Jerusalem. He seems to bring in the women's viewpoint much more, and he has an eye and an ear for those voices which are much lower down the social pecking order. So his story, he kicks off talking about Elizabeth and Zechariah. Zechariah is a priest serving in the temple, and his wife Elizabeth, as a couple, they're older and they have no children. They must have been very highly thought of, because actually that would have been a sign to have been an older couple with no children, a sign of God's displeasure in some ways. And the fact that he is serving in the Holy of Holies means that actually that's been outweighed by the way that people think about them in terms of their behavior. But they have no children. Next in the list is the shepherds that Luke talks about. Shepherds very much poor, on the edge of their community, and really not very highly regarded at all. We then later on also have the characters of Simeon and Anna, older, much older man and a woman, who are waiting and crying out for God to bring the Messiah so that the Israelites could throw off the oppressors and worship God in freedom. Two people who are right at the end of their lives and really peripheral in lots of people's eyes to what God might be doing, and yet they turn out to be central to the story of Jesus' birth. And finally, the last one on the list is Mary, a young teenage girl, probably somewhere between 13 and 15 years old. So a little background information is needed. Looking at Elizabeth and Zechariah, they are related to Mary, and an event happens, you can read it in your Bibles before the reading that we had today, and they again hear from God that they're going to have a child, and they're going to have the child that will become John the Baptist. A couple of things you need to know about the names Zechariah and Elizabeth. Zechariah means God has remembered. Zakar means to remember. But in Hebrew thinking, remembering isn't just a sort of passive act of thinking about something in the past. To remember is to take action. It's a much more dynamic thing. And in this context, where we're saying God has remembered, this is really about God remembering his promises to his people. And the added part of that is Elizabeth. The name Elizabeth in Hebrew means God of oath. God of oath, literally. God's promises. So you have a couple here who are barren, then they don't have children. They're living in a time of oppression from an outside nation, the Romans upon them. And for 400 years, the people have been crying out, praying and crying for God to send his Messiah. This couple have also been crying out for a child, you assume. But perhaps they've reached that stage of life where actually they've given up on it. And there's echoes within that of another couple in the Old Testament, of Abraham and Sarah, who were the founding couple of the nation of Israel, who again were way beyond childbearing years and had no child. And from them comes the line that eventually becomes Israel. And so there's a whole load of stuff that is being played out here in these names that God has drawn into his story. And perhaps that's one of the reasons that he's drawn this particular couple into his purposes, because he wants to tell us something through the names that they have. God remembers his oath. And that's the big part of this word remembering, because what it is, it's about a covenant. It's about remembering promises. And so at the very start of Luke's gospel is this word from a couple who are on the edge of things, that God has remembered his promises and is about to act. And then we move from that couple, and we find the narrative of Mary. Mary meeting with Gabriel. And just looking through this story a little bit, we see the different stages of what happens really when God calls any of us to take action. The first part, when he calls Mary into the center of his purposes, well, the reaction from Mary is fear. I think it's a perfectly rational and reasonable response, firstly in the presence of an angel, but also when God calls us to move forward in our life with him. It's rational and reasonable to feel fear, to be nervous, to be anxious about what God may be doing. And so God speaks a word to Mary, and he speaks peace, really. He says, don't be afraid. It's going to be all right. And I think that when we are making decisions about God, about what God wants us to do, actually it's quite right that we have that test of what we think that God wants us to do. Do we have peace? Doesn't mean that the fear disappears completely. We may be being asked to do something which we think is really beyond our capabilities. So that may remain as we go forward, but we really should be having something of a sense of peace in our hearts before we actually step into what we think God is calling us to. The second part is that Mary questions. Again, God doesn't expect us to just simply go, oh yes, to everything that we think he might be saying to us or challenging us with. It's perfectly okay to say, well, how? How would that work? How would that work? Mary is probably 13, 15 years old, somewhere around that. That's the age at which you would have been betrothed as a young woman. She's not naive, though. She knows where children come from. And she knows that actually that's just not possible. You can almost kind of see a little bit of a smirk coming from her. And I'll explain a little bit more why in a moment. And she just says, well, how? How can this be? You know, I know about the birds and the bees. Come on, tell me. And it's perfectly reasonable to ask God. And the angel doesn't balk at this. He doesn't think that it's a bad thing that Mary has done. And so he seeks to explain. And he says, you will be overshadowed by the Holy Spirit. And this echoes the beginning of Genesis. The beginning of Genesis, where the Holy Spirit hovered over the waters as he was about to do this new thing, bringing creation into being. Then there's a final part here, and I think this is really important, and it goes with this notion of the Spirit overshadowing Mary. That the angel does not say, the Holy Spirit is going to force his presence upon you and make this thing happen. So it's going to overshadow. And what's interesting is the sense that this won't happen unless Mary says yes to it, unless she gives permission. And actually that's what she does. And that's the next part really when God is talking to us and challenging us to move forward in something is he always says, so do you want to do this? Do you want to do this? I'm not going to do it unless you say yes to it. One of the things that often gets said in churches, which I think we sort of laugh at, but actually I think is quite unhelpful. And that's there's a saying that many of us will have heard, which is, if you want to give God a laugh, show him your plans. As if the very last thing on God's mind is to actually work with us in what it is that we want to do. But actually, if you read the scriptures again and again and again, whenever God calls somebody into something, he waits until they say yes to it. He doesn't drive on through without their permission. Because God is not an abusive father. He recognizes that we have a choice. And he makes sure that we're partnering with him. Throughout the scriptures, that's what God wants. He wants partners in his mission, co-laborers. He doesn't want slaves. He doesn't want people that he will drive to do his will. And so Mary here has to reach a point where she says, may it be to me as you have said. And that's the point at which the angel is able to go, brilliant. Now I can go back to God and say, we've got the green light. Mary's up for it. Off we go. So you have these different stages in working through what God might be asking us to do. Fear, anxiety, that initial stage of, oh my goodness, that's too big. That how could I possibly do that? Questioning, practical. Well, this doesn't seem to make sense. How could we get past this obstacle? And then permission. Giving that permission to God that you're going to step into it and you want him to be alongside you. But there's also another practical part of this at the end, and that's that Mary herself is not daft. She's actually quite sharp here. The idea of this sort of impoverished little girl is not really right. The name Mary actually means Miriam. It's the same name as Miriam, and it means bitter, it means rebellious, it means strong and stubborn. It carries something of the emotion, actually, of the nation of Israel as they cry out and pray to God and say, when are you going to do something? And that may also be why God chooses a young woman called Mary, because he wants us to know that he's heard that bitter cry from the people of Israel. But it's also, I think, that Mary's character reflects that stubbornness. She is quite strong. And what happens after she's seen the angel and she's heard these things, she's said yes to them, the first thing she does is she traipses from the north of the country all the way down to the hill country near Jerusalem to see her aunt Elizabeth. So why does she do that? Well, again, because she doesn't take the angel's word for it. The angel said, oh, okay, Elizabeth's having a baby. First thing Mary does is she says, oh, I'm going to check that then. And so she heads all the way down there. This is not an easy journey. She's a young teenage woman, which is probably why she's not an impoverished young woman, because she wouldn't have been able to travel without somebody protecting her and traveling in some kind of caravan down to the hill country. It wasn't a safe journey for her to take. But she chooses to do it. She probably will have gone with another small group of people who would have protected her on that journey. But she goes in order to check out what she's heard. Again, this strong, determined character, which is going to stand her in good stead as the years go on. Because by the time that Jesus reaches his 30s, we know that Joseph is no longer around, and it seems that Mary has raised Jesus and his brothers and sisters on her own. So, the long wait leading up to the arrival of Jesus, about 400 years in Israel's history, crying out for a Messiah to come, coming to a family where part of the family is Zechariah. God has remembered, he has paid attention to, and Elizabeth, God of the oath. And working through a young, slightly rebellious, strong teenage girl who is willing to test what's been said, and then willing to be able to say, okay, I'll step into this. Very often, I think that we can be left waiting for God to act. And I think that's the foundation of the Christmas story, is a nation and individuals who have waited and waited and cried out for God to see him remember and fulfill his promises and move forward. And out of that comes at times a little bit of a bitterness, a stubbornness, a rebellion. God knows that. He knows that it can be challenging. And sometimes it feels like God has slightly abandoned us, even to the point where we may have given up hope for whatever it was that we were crying out for. But the Christmas story tells us one more thing, that persist. Persist in our prayers, persist in crying out to God, because it may take a long time. We may not even see what we're crying out for in our generation, but God will answer answer our prayers and fulfill his promises to us. Let's take a little time to think through this remarkable story as we listen to Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb, veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity.
As I was preparing the talk for this morning, I felt that God had two things really that he might want to say through what we were looking at. And the first one really is for anyone who's watching who is fearful about trusting God, about stepping into that offer from God to be a partner with you, to share your life, to fill your heart. And perhaps because of the way that you've been treated by other people, you have developed a way of living where it's important for you to keep boundaried and protected and in control of what's going on. And I'm not suggesting that you should be throwing those things away, but I think it's perhaps time to let God inside that wall, that you can trust him, that he has your best interests, that he loves you, and he doesn't want to seize all that you are and crush it. That actually he's in the business of encouraging and lifting you up, making you more of what you are, rather than actually making you less. That can be hard for a lot of us. The second thing was really for those who are watching, who you've been waiting for a long time, to see God break through, to see something shift, that you've been hoping for something to happen, living with that hope for a long while. And perhaps it feels now like that moment's passed, it's gone, and you may even have given up on it. And this morning I want to pray for that. I want to pray that if God has made a promise in particular to you, that actually we pray into that and ask that he would fulfill the promise that he's made. So let's pray. Lord God, Father, good Father, this morning I pray that you would soften our hearts where we have had to protect ourselves because of what we've been through, where scars and hurt have forced us to build a shell around ourselves. I pray, Lord, that you would soften that shell for you to be able to come and dwell fully with us. Pray, Lord, where we carry fear, that letting you in might end up hurting us. Pray, Lord, that you release your trust to us this morning, a faith that you are good, that you are always good, and that you will partner with us, not overtake us. And I pray, Lord, for those of us this morning who have been waiting and waiting for a breakthrough, and even for those who the hope is fading, pray, Lord, that you would kindle again a faith to see those things happen. And I pray that you would even bring breakthrough now, that we call on your name, Lord. We call on your name once again to break in to this world and bring your kingdom. Let's wait for a few moments and let God's peace settle upon us by the presence of his Spirit. If you'd like, say the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless us, and preserve us from all evil, and keep us in eternal life. Amen. This is our final hymn now. O Come All Ye Faithful. Thank you for joining me this morning. One last notice which I didn't mention earlier on. All of the churches in Cheltenham are joining together to put on Carols by Carlite up at the racecourse on the 20th of December, 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock. The way this works is you drive up to the racecourse and park in the designated car park in your space. With your household bubble sitting in your car, and you tune in your radio in the car to hear what's being presented from the front, on a stage at the front where they'll do carols, all sorts of other Christmas things. There's space for about 400 cars for each of these events, the 4 o'clock and the 7 o'clock. The 4 o'clock is already completely booked. But if you want to come along to what I'm sure will be a fantastic event, the 7 o'clock still has some spaces, but you're going to need to book really, really quickly if you want to get one of those spaces. If you go to the website lovecheltenham.org, lovecheltenham.org, and there you'll find a link which will take you to the place where you can book your parking space for that event, Carols by Carlite on the 20th. The 7 o'clock one is the only one that's available. So please do book it straight away if you haven't already. Time for a final blessing. May the humility of the shepherds, the faith of the wise men, the joy of the angels, and the peace of the Christ child be God's gift to you and yours this Christmas and always. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon us and remain with us always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.